Welcome from the Centre for Economic Policy Research to another of our special COVID-19 webinars. My name is Tim Phillips. Every day the graphs are spiking and plunging, and the two questions we should ask about that are what's going on and what does it mean? We've got two of the people with us today who are most likely to be able to give us an answer. Torsten Slok is the chief economist at Deutsche Bank in New York. He joins us today. Hello, Torsten. I believe you're in a church.
I am indeed. Good morning.
I can hear the echo. And Richard Portes is professor of economics at the London Business School. And of course, he is the founder and the honorary president of the Centre for Economic Policy Research. Hello, Richard.
Hello, Tim. And Torsten, indeed. I hope you're not having to pray for all of us right now, Torsten.
It may be needed.
Now, for both of you, just before we get started, for policy to be effective, then investors and regulators and governments, we all need a level of common understanding of what's going on, what these market signals mean. As of today, do we have that shared understanding, Torsten?
So I think that we've gotten to a point in the crisis where at least the central banks have reacted, the Federal Reserve and the ECB, with a number of different initiatives that have been helpful. We have finally also seen the Americans come along with a fiscal package as the last of all the major countries. So we are relatively confident that we are beginning to move in the right direction. There's still a lot of things in financial markets that are not quite as calm as we all would like. But the short answer is that we are feeling more optimistic than we have done at least for quite a few weeks.
Richard, do you feel as optimistic?
Not as optimistic, but maybe that's because I'm sitting in Europe and the policy responses on the European side are mainly limited so far to the European Central Bank. The regulators haven't acted. I think what we have seen, as an academic, I can say very confidently, an explosion of academic writing and even new research on all the issues related to this, from the health policy issues and the epidemiology, but also into the finance and economics of it. And a lot of that is beginning to appear and is, I think, very enlightening. And some of the academics understand what's going on in the markets. And some of the policymakers understand what's going on in the markets. I speak to the policymakers a lot because I'm involved in the European Systemic Risk Board, which is the systemic stability macroprudential authority for the European Union. And that involves also interchanges with the national regulators and so forth. So I see both sides of that. I don't see, except for talking with people like Torsten, I don't see that much directly of the markets. So I hope this interchange will be fruitful on both sides.
Let me just add to that. It's clear that markets, of course, have been trying to figure out a framework for thinking about what's going on. And VoxEU and everything that's been going on from the academic side has been incredibly helpful. The speed with which everyone is moving and communicating with each other has certainly been most helpful also for financial markets here.
And that's, of course, why we're here today. So, Torsten, I believe you have some charts to show us of what is going on that you can interpret for us. So please take it away.
So one way to think about what's been going on, at least from a very simple perspective, is to think about what was the impact of the virus once it came along. And in particular, of course, what was the impact of the relatively severe impact that we saw on the corporate sector when suddenly retailers started shutting the doors, factories started standing still, and assembly lines were no longer running. And the number one impact, of course, of shutting your doors to your store is that you no longer have any revenue. And what you see on the first picture here is, of course, that there has been a need to try to raise more cash. And this has shown up in various forms. First of all, of course, in the amount of currency in circulation, both in the US and the euro area, we've seen a modest increase in the amount of cash in the economy as both corporates that no longer have revenue begin to raise more cash, and also households, which unfortunately, as we got the unemployment numbers in the US and the jobless claims, as you know, went up by more than 3 million. That, of course, also means that households have also been trying to raise more cash to, so to speak, build a bridge over the virus and make sure that cash holdings were big enough in this situation where the revenue and wages and salaries was suddenly no longer at the same level, at least at the macro level, as it was before.
So we'll see, I hope, how the in the various different ways in which the in which corporates are raising cash, very liquid assets. And I think that is quite important. And it covers a number of dimensions.
And this is also what you see in the next slide, that the most active players in money market funds are exactly corporates. So corporates have tried to raise more cash with the uncertainty about how long time this will last. It has not been sort of disorderly in any dramatic ways, as we also will see in some of the following slides. But it's been enough to see last week a drop in the total assets in money market funds or prime money market funds in the U.S. of roughly around 10%, which is a relatively significant drawdown, driven, of course, both by redemptions, but also driven by some potential decline in the underlying value of the assets that the money market funds have been holding. So this theme of trying to substitute revenues for corporates and trying to substitute wages for households is, at least very broadly speaking, a very important reason behind most of the things that we have seen in financial markets over the last few weeks.
I believe that Goldman had to bail out one of its prime funds a few days ago. And that is something that we are worrying about, both as academics and policymakers. We're worried about the possibility of runs, not just on money market funds, but on other investment vehicles that do maturity transformation in one way or another.
And one important aspect of this is also how we have seen generally an attempt to raise cash outside of the money market system. In this next slide, we see that the stock market obviously has gone down. This is a very big picture number, namely, what is the total global market value of global stock markets? And as you can see in round numbers, the total value of global stock markets has gone down from around 90 trillion to now roughly around 60 trillion. As you can see, it's a little bit difficult to see in the chart. We have rebounded, of course, a bit here in the last past few days. But generally speaking, one important reason also why stocks sold off so much was, of course, that investors reassessed the underlying cash flows for corporates going forward. But an added reason also was that equities is one of the most liquid markets, and liquid markets have been selling off more simply because it was an easier way both for households to raise cash and also for corporates to raise cash.
Note that that decline in market cap means a decline in the values of pension fund holdings, of insurance company holdings of equities, and of individual household holdings of equities, even if through their retirement plans, whatever. And the result of that, I suspect, is going to be a significant drag on consumption if equity market levels stay well below what they were before, and people will feel a negative wealth effect.
And this, of course, adds to the challenge that the virus is not only closing doors to stores and keeping factories quiet, but it's also the financial market turbulence has the risk of also having a quite significant negative impact on GDP. And of course, as exactly as you say, Richard, consumer spending and what the implications therefore will be if we stay at these relatively low levels of where we still are. The next slide shows nuance in terms of the issues of this need to raise some more cash, namely in commercial paper markets. This is the blue line is the commercial paper for financials. The red line is commercial paper for non-financials. One interesting aspect here is that, as we saw in 2008 and 2009, there a lot of the distresses in markets were in the financial system. As you can see today, now the red line is actually higher than where it was in 2008 and 2009, meaning non-financials is now the area where you're seeing some more distress. And this, of course, is exactly why the Fed decided here very recently to do the commercial paper funding facility. Unfortunately, that will only be up and running here in the first half of April. We have already seen signs that the facility that the Fed has been doing will also begin to help out for any of the stresses that we've seen in commercial paper markets.
Part of the European Central Bank big 750 billion euro package was indeed a provision for the ECB to buy commercial paper issued by non-financials. And that has, the legalities of that have now been sorted out. And I believe that it's actually in force as of today, so that this will be a source, potential source of liquidity for firms. If they issue CP, they can sell it straight away to the ECB.
And with that backdrop, of course, other funding markets and other ways of trying to look at whether there is distress in the financial system is to look at the next page, which shows you the blue line is LIBOR OAS, the red dotted line is FRA OAS, the thin black line is the euro dollar basis swap. And these are essentially different measures of funding markets and short-term money markets. The quick conclusion from this chart is that, yes, there is distress, but a lot of institutions that the Fed has been dusting off from the financial crisis have certainly been most helpful. The initiatives from the ECB also more recently have also been helpful. And as you can see, the basis, meaning the black line, now looks like at least liquidity is back because of the swap lines. And you also look at the, both the red and the blue line, and you conclude that it's worse than what it was in 2011 and also back in 2010 and 2011 with the euro crisis. But again, we are nowhere near the systemic risks and the types of stresses that we saw in 2008 and 2009 when it comes to funding markets. And we are relatively optimistic still that things are now moving in the right direction, thanks to all the initiatives that the central banks have taken up to this point. Turning to a broader measure of distress in financial markets, the red line shows you VIX, which, as you all know, is implied vol in equity markets. The blue line is a similar measure for implied volatility in rates markets and treasury markets. Here, you suddenly can see that the level of distress is now similar to what we were in 2008 and 2009. Of course, implied volatility, as the chart shows, literally out of the blue, jumped up to, for VIX, the highest level that we have ever seen before. And of course, it takes some time. Remember, many quant models and many investors have an exponential memory where they put a relatively high weight to recent history and they put less weight on more distant history. So that means that it will probably take some time before VIX, both for equities and vol measures for treasuries, begin to come down. But the big picture is that it was obviously distressed, but because of the initiatives that Richard and I spoke about on the previous pages that have been implemented, it does look like, at least on some of the indicators that we saw here, that things are getting better. And you should also therefore expect general measures of volatility also to get better over the coming weeks.
Do you think the spike in vol has negatively affected the quant funds that, as you say, whose models are based mainly on recent data rather than historical data?
I do think this has played an important role. As you and I have talked about over the years, with negative interest rates in the euro area, this has created a hunt for yield among investors. And one very popular strategy was the risk parity strategy, or essentially different versions of a carry trade. And a lot of those strategies simply assumed that if you ran a regression on data for the last 5, 6, 7, 8 years, then you would generally have assumed that VIX would always be low. You would generally have assumed that interest rates would always be low. You would generally assume that there will basically be no volatility in financial markets. So given the virus has caused so much of a surprise in jump in measures of volatility and surprise in so many different parts of financial markets, any quant strategy that was relying on a regression of data for the last 5, 6, 7 years would, of course, have been very surprised and in finance terms would have been underperforming because something happened that simply was not assumed in the model. So that's why some of the correlations, including between treasuries and rates markets, have been breaking down simply because things were not trading based on the historical relationships, but suddenly things were trading based on what was liquid. What could I liquidate to quickly raise some cash? The whole new dimension was not incorporated in many of the econometric models or many of the quant models or principal component models that tried to exploit various opportunities in markets that have been there for 5, 6, 7 years, but just have not been there for the last few weeks. This has, of course, spread to discussions about credit risk, which is a much more systemic issue, which is Richard knows much more about than I do. This specific chart here shows you, if you look at the blue line, this is the number of distressed issuers that are trading at more than 1,000 basis points over the benchmark treasury rate. In other words, this shows you the number of bonds that are trading at extreme levels of yields. And you don't get the Nobel Prize in economics for the correlation in this chart here. But we are, of course, quite worried when a number of corporates suddenly are trading at very distressed levels. It does raise the important point that Richard mentioned just before, namely that if this continues to trade at these very distressed levels, then it will have more broad-based implications for wealth effects, for capex decisions, for finance decisions, for the corporate sector, because the implications, of course, would be severe if the costs of financing for any loan for corporates continues to be as expensive as you're seeing in this chart here.
Let me draw that out a bit. The prospect of a major wave of ratings downgrades for corporate bonds. These bonds are held in good part by pension funds, by insurers, and so forth. If those bonds, and there's a lot of triple B paper out there, hundreds of billions, both in Europe and in the United States, if those bonds suddenly go below investment grade, the institutions typically will be forced to sell them. That will be a fire sale situation. How do you see that playing out?
This is what we see on the next chart. This shows you the market cap of different parts of the credit stack in terms of credit quality and the gray area. Exactly as you just mentioned, the amount of BAA or BBB outstanding is much bigger today than what it was before. And the risk of a fallen angel situation or the risk of a situation where bonds get downgraded would be very serious, of course, for those that are holding those bonds. And it's particularly serious because if you look at the IG index today, it used to be the case that 25% of the IG index was BBB. BBB is the lowest rated quality you can have in investment grade. But today it's around 50% of the investment grade index that is BBB, meaning the amount of bonds inside the index which are lower rated has unfortunately gone up quite significantly. And many institutions, both in, of course, US and Europe, are not allowed to hold high yield and can only hold investment grade. So if you have a downgrade of the lowest credit quality down to high yield, the risks would indeed be important for the global financial system. Limiting the negative impact on the macroeconomy is critical, of course, most importantly, to make sure that people don't lose their jobs and to make sure that people get some compensation in the form of unemployment benefits or other things. But it's actually also very, very important to make sure that we avoid this risk that you're mentioning, which is very important, Richard, that we have a downgrade problem on our hands where suddenly you could have a fire selling or forced selling among some investors if you see a downgrade of the investment grade index that they are holding. So we don't believe we will get into that situation, and we don't believe that this problem will create any systemic risks. But this is obviously something that needs to be watched very carefully.
It would hit the corporate bond funds too and the ETFs, no?
It would indeed. We have seen a bit of that in the flows. If you look at US mutual funds and ETFs that are invested in corporate credit, we don't really know very well why we have seen redemptions. It could, of course, be because households need cash to pay their bills now that many people have lost their jobs. It could also be that people worry about the underlying quality of credit. But in the last few days, we have seen, thankfully, quite a rally, quite an improvement in investment grade credit. Also, even a high yield, we've also seen quite a rally, suggesting that investors are beginning to come back to corporate credit, that this will be a more temporary shock. But the next page shows the global ramifications of that important point that you're raising, namely that if you look at the question of who are the holders of U.S. corporate credit, and the red line in this chart here shows you that the biggest holder of U.S. corporate credit is foreigners. If you look very carefully in the chart, you can see that the red line, this is the percentage of U.S. investment grade and high yield held by different entities. And the red line shows you foreigners started increasing the share that they were holding of U.S. corporate credit in 2014 when the ECB introduced negative interest rates. When interest rates turned negative, global investors, in particular in Europe and Japan, began hunting yield. And one area that there was significant hunt for yield was in U.S. credit, which is what you could see in the red line here. It's been a little bit more bumpy more recently when the Fed began to raise rates in 2015. Then we began to see in 18 also, of course, more appetite for buying the risk-free asset, meaning rates rather than corporate credit. Then the Fed, of course, would be lowering rates. So now the red line has been going up. But the bottom line in this from a systemic issue, of course, is that a lot of U.S. corporate credit is held abroad, which is basically bringing me to the bottom line that the U.S. corporate credit challenges are not just an issue in the U.S., but is also an issue for the rest of the world because of this significant ownership abroad. And this brings me to the final chart, that I brought along here, namely the overall measure of financial conditions. There are various indicators. We in Deutsche Bank also have our own measure, but these two are the ones from the Office of Financial Research, which is part of the U.S. Treasury, as you know. The red line is the Bloomberg measure of financial conditions, and these indicators are daily. And sometimes when macro investors ask me what's going on, how distressed are things, show me a picture that tries to summarize everything that we are thinking about. This chart here is one way of doing that, namely to look at, well, overall, and the way this is calculated, this is important, is that you throw into the kitchen sink all the measures that we have spoken about on the previous pages that have daily numbers, and you then do principal components and ask the question, what is the variation that these measures have in common? The nuance in how this is calculated is that sometimes you then ask, okay, I want those measures and I want that variation to be captured in a series, but I want that series to be correlated with GDP or correlated with the unemployment rate. But no matter how you look at it, no matter how sophisticated methods that you do, you end up with a picture at the moment that things today are not as distressed as they were in 2008 and 9, but they are more distressed than what they were during the euro crisis in 2011. So the main conclusion to Richard's good point earlier is that the longer this lasts, of course, the distress in financial markets will have a longer lasting impact on the economy. But given what the Fed has been doing, given what the ECB has been doing, we do believe that financial distress will begin to come down. In other words, we will see these stresses ease over the coming week or two, and that should also therefore limit the negative impact of the distress from financial markets on the economy, both in the US and in the euro area, in our view.
Going back to 2008, 2009, that period when the red line was above, or either line, was above where it is now. Roughly speaking, how long did that last? When I'm looking at the graph, it's hard for me to tell.
That's true, and it is a good point. So I made the argument here that this is going to be relatively short-lived. The argument for this to be short-lived today is that the reason why we had 2008 and 9 was that we had some imbalances in the economy that had been building up. We had some imbalances in 2006 and 2007 with the housing market. If you go back to the recession in 2000, we had some imbalances because of the IT sector and technology sector having overinvested, too much investment in technology. And if you go back to 1990, we had imbalances because of the commercial real estate sector. So one logic that I think about the situation today is that this distress we're experiencing is not driven by an imbalance in housing or IT or commercial real estate. It really, literally, the virus came out of the blue. And there were not that many imbalances, at least broadly speaking, in the economy from a GDP perspective, which also, therefore, to your good question, makes me somewhat confident that it will not last as long. We just need the virus to go away. So, and I know this is, of course, what it's all about. But in some sense, these pictures here is that the policy initiatives have been able to flatten out, if you will, the recession curve. And now what we just need to wait for is to see a flattening out of the virus curve. It will surely be bumpy still, but at least the support both for monetary policy and fiscal policy has been much more aggressive, much quicker out of the box this time around, which also gives me some more confidence that this will be more short-lived relative to what we saw, particularly in 2008 and 9.
I think that there's some reason for that optimism, although I think that the original feeling that this was going to be a really V-shaped affair and there'd be one quarter in which there'd be a sharp shock and then you'd see a recovery in the next quarter. It's going to be at least two quarters, and we don't know how much further than that it's going to extend. And it, as you say, it depends on the spread of the virus, the impact of the virus, and how long productive capacity will be shut down in various ways. Some of that productive capacity won't come back, of course, and that's something to bear in mind, that a lot of the service sector is shaky. Some of it's closing down already. Some of it is forcibly closed down. Some of that will just not come back. Some airlines will be eliminated. Some air transport capacity will be eliminated overall. The planes won't go away, but you will find demand for travel down. I mean, just an example. You'll find demand for travel down for a long time. So we have to bear in mind that turning the corner on the GDP side is not going to be that easy. Can I go back, Torsten, to discussing some of the financial issues now? One thing that concerns me, I mentioned there was a run on a Goldman Prime money market fund. That was just one fund. We could, however, think about the possibility that people really will get spooked and that there will be runs on a number of investment funds of one kind or another. The natural response to that would be redemption gates, but there are no consistent policies, I believe, from the regulators about how and when to use redemption gates. Is this likely to happen in the U.S., do you think, at all?
So the important part of that question is that it's difficult to assess why we're seeing these withdrawals. Are we seeing these withdrawals because there is just a simple need to have some precautionary savings? I just need to have some more cash as a household or as a corporate?
Yep.
Or is there really a worry about a profound insolvency or panic in financial markets or a much more distressed fear of what's going on? So, but you're right, it is important to monitor the outflow situation across all kinds of funds to figure out how significant these issues are, because this creates fire selling and this creates forced selling. So another way of saying that is that normally we think about financial markets as pricing is driven by fundamentals, the future cash flow of a company, or the future outlook for an economy in terms of where government bonds and the future outlook for inflation. But if there suddenly is some selling of assets that's not related by fundamental consideration, but by consideration about the system, or in this case, a need for cash, then you're absolutely right. The issue of systemic risks, which you know much more about than me, does become very important.
No, it's an issue that concerns us. Another related phenomenon is something we have been seeing, we know we've been seeing, and that is corporates drawing on their credit lines with banks such as your own. All the big banks have substantial credit lines available to their big clients, at least, to draw upon more or less on demand, on reasonable terms. And many corporates have availed themselves of this opportunity because they want cash. Right? They are worried about their liquidity positions. You can imagine which firms we're talking about. Now, that then puts pressure on the banks, no? And the question is what the bank can do. One thing the bank can do is to try to get their corporate clients to, instead of drawing on the credit lines, to issue commercial paper or to issue bonds that, in the European case at least, and maybe with the CPFF in the United States, would then be bought up by the central bank. Do you see this as a major issue, this rush for cash, getting their cash from you, right?
You're right. That brings us back to what is the underlying theme of everything that's been going on. And I think that the different institutions that the Fed has taken out of the closet and dusted off and implemented very, very quickly, in some sense, Jay Powell was quote-unquote lucky that Bernanke already had created these institutions 10 years ago and now could just open the drawer and take them out again. Those institutions are very important in that regard. It is helpful when you look at how spreads have been moving, as you also we spoke about in some of the pictures we showed here. We have seen definitely signs of easing in funding markets, signs of easing in investment grade and high yield markets. So it is the underlying theme, the need for cash. But the good news is that the institutions have now been built. It takes some time for things to calm a bit down, but I'm still very optimistic that we have seen a lot of the action that will be helpful and bring us back in a more normal situation again.
Richard, on that topic, within Europe, do you see a reason to loosen or pause some of the regulatory restrictions on banks?
Well, the banks have already been told that they can use some of their capital buffers to bolster their capital position if they're worried about that. There are other things that the regulators can do and may do, like restricting their ability to pay dividends, like restricting their ability to pay bonuses, like restricting their ability to have stock buybacks using their capital. So that the regulators are, on the one hand, being flexible in certain respects, but they may well be rather more restrictive in other respects. I think we don't quite know that yet, which way they'll go. But I was hoping, Tim, that we might have taken Torsten's note of optimism there, given that we're running out of time, that we should end on a note of optimism. The regulators are there. The regulators are working day and night to try to keep the system in good shape. As Torsten said, the Fed developed tools in 2008-2009, the European Central Bank developed tools in the euro crisis in the early 2010s, and there are a lot of experienced people out there who are trying to grapple with the financial sector consequences of this huge shock from outside the financial system. And that, of course, is what, as Torsten said, differentiates it from the 2008-2009, and indeed from the 2011-2012, the euro crisis, that the shock really is coming from outside. The financial structure is somewhat better prepared, significantly better prepared to deal with it, but I hope that Torsten's optimism is justified.
Well, on that positive, well, a semi-positive note, we are out of time, as Richard says. So thank you to Richard and Torsten. Now, we are planning some more of these, so keep coming back to the COVID-19 section at VoxEU. You'll find a lot of new research, but you'll also be able to check up to see what we're planning, because we're hoping to put on some live events soon. I'm sure that you would have a lot of questions when we do, so we want to make sure that those get answered for you. For now, from the Centre for Economic Policy Research, goodbye.